This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Crash Bandicoot is a platform video game developed by Naughty Dog and published by Sony Computer Entertainment for the PlayStation. It was originally released for the PlayStation on September 9, 1996, and was included in the Sony Greatest Hits lineup in 2007. It was re-released as a downloadable game on the PlayStation Network, and its remastered version is scheduled to be released for the PlayStation 4 in 2017. Crash Bandicoot is the first installment in the Crash Bandicoot series, chronicling the creation of the title character at the hands of the series antagonist Doctor Neo Cortex and his henchman Doctor Nitrus Brio. The game's story follows Crash's effort to stop Brio and Cortex's plans for world domination, and to save his girlfriend Tawna, a female bandicoot also evolved by Brio and Cortex. Crash Bandicoot received generally positive reviews from critics, who praised the game's graphics and unique visual style, but criticized its controls and noted the game's lack of innovation as a platform game. The game would later go on to become one of the best-selling PlayStation video games. Contents 1 Gameplay 2 Plot 21 Characters 22 Setting 23 Story 3 Development 31 Conception 32 Character and Art Design 33 Graphics 34 Level Design 35 Post-Production 36 Japanese Distribution 4 Reception 5 Sequels 6 References 7 Bibliography Gameplay Crash Bandicoot Gameplay Breaking crates often rewards the player with Wumpa Fruit. When 100 Wumpa Fruit are collected, the player earns an extra life. The player controls Crash Bandicoot, who must traverse several levels in sequence in order to progress. The player is given a certain amount of lives, which are lost when Crash is attacked by an enemy, or falls into water or a pit. If all lives are lost at any point in the game, the game over screen will appear, at which point the player may continue from the last time they saved their progress. Crash's primary abilities are jumping and spinning. Most enemies may be defeated by jumping on them or spinning into them. An enemy that is attacked by Crash's spin attack can be launched into another enemy that is on screen at the same time. These same techniques can be used to open the numerous boxes found in each stage. Most boxes in the game contain Wumpa Fruit, which give the player an extra life if 100 of them are collected. Another item found inside crates is the Witch Doctor's Mask, which shields Crash from one enemy attack. Collecting 3 of these masks in a row grants Crash temporary invulnerability from all minor dangers. Arrow boxes marked with arrows pointing up propel Crash further than his ordinary jump can, while TNT boxes explode after a 3-second fuse when jumped on. Boxes with an exclamation mark on them cause previously intangible objects in the area to solidify. Checkpoint boxes allow Crash to return to the point where the first checkpoint box has been opened upon losing a life. If more than one checkpoint box has been opened in a stage, Crash returns to the last checkpoint box that has been opened. Special tokens can also be found inside boxes. These tokens may feature the likenesses of Tawna, Dr. Neo Cortex or Dr. Nitrus Brio. When 3 tokens have been collected in one stage, the on-screen action freezes and Crash is immediately teleported to a bonus round. In the bonus round, the player must break open a large number of boxes to earn Wumpa Fruit and special items such as keys to hidden areas. If Crash falls off the screen in the bonus round, he is transported back to the level he came from. Rather than losing a life, he is also transported back to the level if the bonus round has been successfully traversed. If the player can complete an entire level without losing a life after breaking open a checkpoint box, a special stage clear screen appears in which the player is informed of how well they've done and if any special items have been earned. They are also shown how many boxes, if any, have been missed in the level. If a life has been lost during the stage, the player is simply returned to the world map. If the player manages to both complete a level without losing a life after breaking open a checkpoint box and break open all of the boxes in that level, they are awarded a gem. Gems allow the player to enter new areas in previously completed levels that were not accessible before. Plot Characters Main Article Characters of Crash Bandicoot. The playable protagonist character is Crash Bandicoot, a Bandicoot who has been mutated by an invention called the Evolvo Ray. The main antagonist is Dr. Neo Cortex, a mad scientist who was often ridiculed by the scientific community for his outlandish theories and is now motivated to prove his tormentors wrong by creating a mutated army of animals to conquer the world. Cortex's henchman is Dr. Nitrus Brio, the insecure creator of the Evolvo Ray. Crash's love interest is Tawna, a female bandicoot about to undergo experimentation by the doctors. Helping Crash in his journey is an ancient witch doctor spirit by the name of Aku Aku, who has scattered masks of himself throughout the islands to grant Crash special invincibility. antibody powers. The boss characters of the game include Papu Papu, an obese and short-tempered chief of the native village, Ripper Roo, a demented kangaroo with razor-sharp toenails, Koala Kong, a muscular but unintelligent koala, and Pinstripe Potaroo. Dr. Cortex's Tommy gun-wielding bodyguard. Setting the game is set on the Woompa Islands, a group of three fictional Australian islands owned by Dr. Neo Cortex. Levels are typically set in tribesmen's villages, fortresses or beaches. Some levels on the second island also take place in temple ruins, bridges high above the mountains, and a volcanic mine. Levels on the third island feature much more industrial settings, including a large power plant and a castle. The tropical setting of the game was inspired by Donkey Kong Country. Story. With the aid of his assistant Dr. Nitrus Brio, Dr. Neo Cortex creates the Evolvo Ray, which he uses to mutate the various animals living on the islands into beasts with superhuman strength. They experiment on a peaceful bandicoot named Crash, who Cortex intends to be the military leader of his growing army of animal soldiers. Despite warnings from Brio, Cortex subjects Crash to the untested Cortex Vortex in an attempt to put him under his control. The experiment proves to be a failure as the Vortex rejects Crash after Crash escapes Cortex's castle by leaping out a window and falling into the ocean below. Cortex prepares a female bandicoot named Tawna for experimentation, having grown attached to Tawna during their time in captivity. Crash resolves to rescue her and defeat Cortex from the beach of Insanity Island. Crash makes his way through the nearby jungle and scales the wall of a giant wooden fortress, which is inhabited by the native tribe. Crash then enters the hut of tribe leader Papu Papu and is forced to defeat him in self-defense after inadvertently waking him from his nap riding on the back of a wild hog. Crash escapes the pursuing villagers and climbs over the opposite fortress wall from there. Crash crosses to the second of Cortex's islands, Woompa Island, hosting a large tree, has been long abandoned and there is nothing more than a jungle, a lizard infested city, dilapidated bridges high in the mountains, and the ruins of an ancient temple. However, having discovered that Crash was making his way across the islands, Cortex dispatches the deranged Ripper Roo on the island in a temple at the start of a creek. Crash manages to cross the river and, after avoiding contact with his razor-sharp toenails, knocks Ripper Roo out cold beside a waterfall, and successfully makes his way through the city and the temples. Crash also defeats another of Cortex's mutants, Koala Kong, in a volcanic cave mine before finally crossing to the Cortex Island. Crash then navigates the Cortex Power Station, a huge power plant that provides Cortex's castle with energy while polluting the nearby area. When he reaches the factory core, Crash battles and defeats the CEO of Cortex Power, Pinstripe Potaroo, damaging the power plant. Unable to enter Cortex's castle after getting there via bridge, Crash climbs the tower walls, and enters the castle through the window he had previously escaped from after making his way through the dark hallways and the castle's many machines. Crash is confronted by Brio inside his laboratory. Brio uses chemicals to mutate himself into a monster while Crash is successful in defeating Brio. The castle laboratory catches chemical fire during the struggle. Crash escapes to Cortex's airship, where he confronts Cortex himself as the castle burns. Cortex attacks him with a plasma gun, but Crash deflects his own projectiles against him and sends Cortex falling out of the air. United with Tawna, they escape the burning castle. On Cortex's airship development, Andy Gavin, Jason Rubin Gavin and Rubin Co. created the concept for Crash Bandicoot during a cross-country trip from Boston to Los Angeles. Conception before presenting Way of the Warrior to Mark Cerny of Universal Interactive Studios. Naughty Dog was signed on to the company for three additional games in August 1994. Jason Rubin and Andy Gavin began their move from Boston, Massachusetts to Los Angeles, California before leaving. Gavin and Rubin hired Dave Baggett, their first employee and a friend of Gavin's from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Baggett would not start working full-time until January 1995. During the trip, Gavin and Rubin studied arcade games intensely and noticed that racing, fighting and shooting games had begun making a transition into full 3D rendering sensing opportunity. They turned to their favorite video game genre, the character-based action platform game, and asked themselves what a three-dimensional version of such a game would be like, because the player would be forced to constantly look at the character rear. The hypothetical game was jokingly called Sonic's Ass Game, the basic technology. for the game and the Crash Bandicoot series as a whole was created somewhere near Gary, Indiana. The rough game theory was designed near Colorado soon afterward. Gavin and Ruben threw out their previous game design for Al-O-Saurus and Dynastine, a side-scrolling video game based on time travel, and scientists genetically merged with dinosaurs in August 1994. Naughty Dog moved into their new Universal City, California offices and met with Mark Cerny. The group unanimously liked the Sonic's Ass game idea and debated on what video game system the game would be for, deciding that the 3DO Interactive Multiplayer, Atari Jaguar, Sega 32X, and Sega Saturn were unsatisfactory options due to poor sales and clunky development units. The team chose to develop the game for Sony's PlayStation due to the console's sexy nature and the company's lack of an existing competing mascot character. After signing a developer agreement with Sony, Naughty Dog paid $35,000 for a PlayStation development unit and received the unit in September 1994. A development budget of $17 million was set for the game, and former Sunsoft director David Siller was hired to be the producer, character and art design before the development of Crash Bandicoot. Naughty Dog wanted to do what Sega and Warner Brothers did while designing their respective characters, Sonic the Hedgehog and the Tasmanian Devil, and incorporate an animal that was cute, real, and no one really knew about. The team purchased a field guide on Tasmanian mammals and selected the wombat, Potaroo, and Bandicoot as options. Gavin and Ruben went with Willy the Wombat as a temporary name for the starring character of the game. The name was never meant to be final due both to the name sounding too dorky and to the existence of a non-video game property of the same name. The character was effectively a Bandicoot by October 1994, but was still referred to as Willy the Wombat. As a final name had not been formulated yet, it was decided that the main character would be mute because past voices for video game characters were considered to be lame, negative, and distracted from identification with them. The villain of the game was created while Gavin, Ruben, Baggett, and Cerny were eating mediocre Italian near the Universal Studios. Gavin idealized an evil genius villain with a big head who was all about his attitude and his minions. Ruben, having become fond of the animated television series Pinky and the Brain, imagined a more malevolent brain with minions resembling the weasel characters in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. After Gavin performed a silly villain voice depicting the attitude in mind for the character, the villain's name, Dr. Neo Cortex, was instantly formulated to aid in the visual aspect of production. David Siller recruited Joe Pearson of Epic Inc., who in turn recommended that Charles Zembelas of American Exodus be brought on board as well. Pearson and Zembelas would meet with Naughty Dog weekly to create the characters and environments of the game. Because the main character was Tasmanian, it was decided that the game would take place on a mysterious island where every possible type of environment could be found, with the added reasoning that an evil genius like Dr. Neo Cortex would require an island stronghold on creating the levels for the game. Pearson first sketched each environment, designing and creating additional individual elements. Later, Pearson aimed for an organic, overgrown look to the game and worked to completely avoid straight lines and 90-degree corners. In January 1995, Ruben became concerned about the programmer-to-artist ratio and hired Bob Rafay and Taylor Kurosaki as additional artists. A Naughty Dog artist sketched every single background object in the game before it was modeled. Naughty Dog's artists were tasked with making the best use of textures and reducing the amount of geometry. Dark and light elements were juxtaposed to create visual interest and separate geometry. The artists would squint when sketching, texturing, and playing the levels to make sure they could be played by light value alone. They ensured to use color correctly by choosing mutually accentuating colors as the theme for the Lost City and Sunset Vista levels. The interior of Cortex's castle was designed to reflect the inside of his mind. Graphics: the PlayStation had a 512 by 240 video mode and used up video memory that would normally be used for textures, but was effective in rendering shaded if untextured polygons. Ruben pointed out that since the polygons on the characters were just a few pixels in size, shaded characters would look better than textured ones. Thus, polygons were emphasized over textures. This was advantageous in that it allowed the programmers more polygons to work with and allowed them to work around the PlayStation's lack of texture correction or polygon clipping to give the game more of a resemblance to an animated cartoon. Vertex animation was implemented rather than the standard skeletal animation with one joint weighting. This allowed the programmers to use the more sophisticated 3-4 joint weighting available in Power Animator because the PlayStation was unable to match this. At at runtime, the location of every vertex was stored in every frame at 30 frames a second. Gavin, Baggett, and Cerny attempted to invent assembly language vertex compressors for this manner of animation. Cerny's version was the most successful and the most complicated to obtain the graphic details seen in the game. Rubin, Gavin, and Baggett researched visibility calculation in video games that followed Doom and concluded that extensive pre-calculation of visibility would allow the game to render a larger number of polygons following experimentation in free-roaming camera control. The team settled with a branching rail camera that would follow along next to, behind, or in front of the character, generally looking at him, moving on a track through the world because only 800 polygons could be visible on the screen at a time. Parts of the game's landscape would be hidden from view using trees, cliffs, walls, and twists and turns in the environment because the production used an entirely Silicon Graphics and IRIX-based tool pipeline. The programmers used $100,000 Silicon Graphics workstations instead of the $3,000 personal computers that were the standard at the time. Gavin created an algorithmic texture packer that would deal with the fact that the 512x240 video mode left too little texture memory. Meanwhile, Baggett created bidirectional 10x compressors that would reduce the 128MB levels down to 12MB and allow them to be compatible with the PlayStation's 2MB random access memory. The levels proved to be so large that the first test level created could not be loaded into Alias Power Animator and had to be cut up into 16 chunks. Each chunk took about 10 minutes to load even on a 256MB machine. To remedy the situation, Baggett created the DLE, a level design tool where component parts of a level were entered into a text file, with a series of Adobe Photoshop layers indicating how the parts were combined to code the characters and gameplay of the game. Andy Gavin and Dave Baggett created the programming language Game-Oriented Object Lisp GUL using Lisp syntax level design. The first two test levels created for the game did not ship in the final version for being too open and featuring too many polygons. During the summer of 1995, the team focused on creating levels that were functional as well as fun and used the Cortex Factory levels to experiment on this goal. The mechanical setting allowed the team to forego the complex and organic forest designs and distill the two-axis gameplay in an attempt to make it fun. Their first two successful levels, Heavy Machinery and Generator Room, utilized 25D gameplay and featured basic techniques previously used in Donkey Kong Country, such as steam vents, drop platforms, bouncy pads, heated pipes, and enemy characters that would move back and forth, all of which would be arranged in progressively more difficult combinations as the level went on. Willy's jumping, spinning, and bonking mechanisms were refined in these two levels. The level Cortex Power incorporates the original Sonic's ass point of view behind the character and over his shoulder featured in the two test levels. After working on those three levels, the first successful jungle themed level, later titled Jungle Rollers, was created from pieces of the failed first test level arranged into a corridor between trees. From that point forward, two to three levels would be created for each level theme featured, with the first level featuring an introductory set of challenges and later levels adding new obstacles such as dropping and moving platforms in the second jungle-themed level to increase the difficulty while playing the game. During development, Rubin realized that there were many empty areas in the game due to the PlayStation's inability to process numerous on-screen enemy characters at the same time. Additionally, test players were solving the game's puzzles too fast. In an attempt to remedy this, the Woompa Fruit pickup was created. The fruits themselves were rendered in 3D into a series of textures, but was not exciting enough on its own. On a Saturday in January 1996, Gavin coded the crates while Rubin modeled a few basic crates and an exploding TNT crate and drew quick textures. The first few crates were placed in the game 6 hours later, and many more would be placed during the following days. Post-production in September 1995, Andy Gavin and Taylor Kurosaki took footage from the game and spent 2 days editing it into a 2-minute preview tape, which would be deliberately leaked to a friend at Sony Computer Entertainment so that the company may view it. Due to management issues at Sony, it would not be until March 1996 that Sony would agree to publish the game, which went into the alpha stage in April 1996. While preparing for the game's demonstration at the Electronic Entertainment Expo, the team decided to finally rename the title character Crash Bandicoot, the particular name being credited to Dave Baggett and Taylor Kurosaki, with his surname being based on his canonical species and his first name stemming from the visceral reaction to the character's destruction of boxes, Dash, Smash, and Bash. were other potential names. The name change was contested between Naughty Dog and marketing director Kelly Flaherty, who was discredited in postmortems by Gavin and Rubin. The music of Crash Bandicoot was a last-minute aspect added to the game before its showing at the Electronic Entertainment Expo. The producer of Universal Interactive proposed that rather than conventional music, an urban chaotic symphony would be created by Andy Gavin, causing random sound effects such as bird vocalizations, vehicle horns, grunts, and flatulence to be randomly selected and combined. When this proposal was rejected, David Siller introduced the team to the music production company Mutato Musica and its founder Mark Mothersbaugh. Following this introduction, Mothersbaugh selected Josh Mansell to compose the music for the game based on his previous work on Johnny Mnemonic. The interactive movie Mothersbaugh advised Mansell throughout the soundtrack's demo stages, after which all composition duties of Crash Bandicoot and Naughty Dog's subsequent six titles were delegated to Mansell. Mouse on Mars, A Guy Called Gerald, Aphex Twin and Juan Atkins served as influences on Mansell's simple but kind of off-kilter melodies. Dave Baggett served as the soundtrack's producer. The sound effects were created by Mike Gollum, Ron Horwitz and Kevin Spears of Universal Sound Studios. The voices in the game were provided by Brendan O'Brien in a continuing attempt by Universal Interactive to take credit for Crash Bandicoot. Naughty Dog was told that it was not allowed to go to the first Electronic Entertainment Expo. In addition, there were leaked copies of the temporary box cover and press materials for the Electronic Entertainment Expo, upon which the Naughty Dog logo, in violation of the contract between Naughty Dog and Universal Interactive, was omitted. In response, Jason Rubin drafted and printed 1,000 copies of a document entitled Naughty Dog, Creator and Developer of Crash Bandicoot, to hand out in front of the Crash Bandicoot display at the Electronic Entertainment Expo. Beforehand, Rubin passed out the flyers for review to Universal Interactive, angering its president. Crash Bandicoot was first shown at the Electronic Entertainment Expo on May 1996 and was met with enthusiastic reactions. The game was released on September 9, 1996. This was followed by its European release on November 8, 1996. Japanese distribution. In preparation for presenting Crash Bandicoot to Sony Japanese division, Gavin spent a month studying anime and manga, reading English language books on the subject, watching Japanese films and observing competitive characters in video games. Upon Naughty Dog's first meeting with the executives of Sony Computer Entertainment Japan, the executives handed Naughty Dog a document that compared Crash with Mario and Nights into Dreams. Although Crash was rated favorably in the graphics department, the main character and the game's non-Japanese heritage were seen as weak points. The renderings of the character made specifically for the meeting also proved unimpressive. During a break following the initial meeting, Gavin approached Charlotte Francis, the artist responsible for the renderings, and gave her 15 minutes to adjust Crash's facial structures. Sony Japan bought Crash for Japanese distribution after being shown the modified printout pop-up text. Instructions given by Aku Aku were added for the Japanese version of the game. Reception aggregate score aggregator score game rankings 80% review scores publication score EGM 83/10 game informer 9/10 game pro 45/5 game revolution B IGN 75/10 gaming target 93/10. Crash Bandicoot received generally favorable reviews from critics, with much of the positive comments going to the graphics. Dave Halverson of GameFan referred to the visuals as the best graphics that exist in a game, and the design and animations of the title character as 100% perfection. John Scalzo of Gaming Target described the environments as colorful and detailed, and mentioned the snowy bridge and temple levels as his favorites. However, he noted that the boss characters appeared to be noticeably polygonal compared to the other characters due to their large size. Nevertheless, he added that this flaw was excusable because of the game's age and that the game's graphics were near perfect. Otherwise, a reviewer for Game Revolution singled out the scaling technology for praise and declared it to be the new standard for PlayStation action games, the same way SGI did for 16-bitters after Donkey Kong Country. Additionally, he described the texture mapping precision as awesome, the shading as almost too well done. The reviewer claimed it made the game more difficult by making the pits appear to be shadows and vice versa, the polygon movements as very smooth and fluid, the quirky mannerisms of the title character as always refreshing, and the backgrounds as breathtakingly beautiful, especially the waterfall stages. However, the reviewer said that the ability to adjust the camera angle even slightly would have been a definite plus. At times the ground itself is at 75-degree angle while Crash constantly moves at 90 degrees, putting a slight strain on the eyes. A reviewer for IGN noted that gorgeous backgrounds and silky smooth animation make this one of the best-looking titles available for the PlayStation. The gameplay received mixed responses. Both John Scalzo and the Game Revolution reviewer compared the gameplay to Donkey Kong Country, with Scalzo describing the game as having a familiar, yet unique quality that he attributed to Naughty Dog's design, while the Game Revolution reviewer concluded that the game fails to achieve anything really new or revolutionary. As a platform game, the IGN reviewer said that the game isn't a revolution in platform game design, it's pretty much your standard platform game. However, he noted the game's surprisingly deep depth of field and use of different perspectives as exceptions to the platforming formula. Jim Sterling of Destructoid.com stated that the game has aged poorly since its initial release and cited the lack of DualShock thumbsticks, a poor camera, as well as substandard jumping and spinning controls as of November 2003. Crash Bandicoot has sold over 68 million units worldwide, making it one of the best-selling PlayStation video games of all time. The game's success led to its inclusion for the Sony Greatest Hits. Crash Bandicoot was the first non-Japanese game to receive a gold prize in Japan for sales of over 500,000 units. The game spent nearly 2 years on the NPD-TRS-TS top 20 PlayStation sales charts before finally dropping off on September 1998. Sequels. Further information: Crash Bandicoot. Following the release of Crash Bandicoot, Naughty Dog created two sequels, Crash Bandicoot 2, Cortex Strikes Back 1997, and Crash Bandicoot, Warped 1998, as well as a kart racing game titled Crash Team Racing 1999. Each installment was also made for the PlayStation, and Crash Team Racing was the final Crash Bandicoot game the company developed before moving onto the Jak and Daxter series. After Crash Team Racing, Euricum developed the final Crash Bandicoot game for the PlayStation, the party game Crash Bash. References: Universal, P7 Universal, PP8-9 Universal, PP9-10 Universal, P11 Universal, P12 Universal, PP19-22 AB setting. Retrieved 15 June 2007. Computer Entertainment Level Area Opening Sequence. Doctor Neo Cortex, prepare the female Bandicoot. AB Naughty Dog. August 31, 1996. Crash Bandicoot. PlayStation. Sony. Computer Entertainment Level Area Sunset Vista. Naughty Dog. August 31, 1996. Crash Bandicoot. PlayStation. Sony. Computer Entertainment Level Area Fumbling in the Dark. Jason Rubin. 2004. Fear: An Appropriate Response to the Future of Video Game Development. Morgan Rose. Retrieved November 23, 2015. 2011. Cross-examination of yesterday and today's best-selling platform games. P. 2. Cortex Strikes Back. Warped. The Wrath of Cortex. To Insanity. Crash of the Titans. Mind Over. Mutant Racing. Team Racing. Nitro Kart. Tag Team Racing. Party Bash. Boom Bang. Handheld. The Huge Adventure 2. Entranced. Purple. Ripto's Rampage. Mobile Games. Developers: Naughty Dog. Traveler's Tales. Radical Entertainment. Vicarious Visions. Euricum. Dimps. Related articles. Characters: Crash Bandicoot. Doctor Neo Cortex. Skylanders. Imaginators. Crash Bandicoot Remastered Collection. VE. Naughty Dog Video Games. Crash Bandicoot. Crash Bandicoot 1996. Crash Bandicoot 2. Cortex Strikes Back 1997. Crash Bandicoot. Warped 1998. Crash Team Racing 1999. Jak and Daxter. Jak and Daxter: The Precursor. Legacy 2001. Jak 2 2003. Jak 3 2004. Jak X Combat Racing 2005. Uncharted. Uncharted Drake's Fortune 2007. Uncharted 2 Among Thieves 2009. Uncharted 3 Drake's Deception 2011. Uncharted 4, A Thief's End 2016. Other games: Math Jam 1985, Ski Crazed 1986, Dream Zone 1987. Keith the Thief 1989, Rings of Power 1991, Way of the Warrior 1994, The Last of Us 2013, Left Behind 2014, Remasters, Jak and Daxter Collection 2012, The Last of Us Remastered 2014, Uncharted, The Nathan Drake Collection 2015, People, Neil Druckmann, Bruce Strally, Andy Gavin, Jason Rubin, Tom Bissell. Related: Sony Interactive Entertainment. ICE Team. List. Category.